Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 13th chapter, verses 24 through 30. And as we continue in our time of talking about the parables and having this school theme, we have another young person who's going to share with us, and it happens to be the same weekend as his birthday.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field, but while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you are pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, 'First collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn.'"
So if you happen to see Liam this morning, wish him a happy birthday. Will you bow with me for a moment of prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for your word that continues to ring deep within our hearts and within our minds and with our soul, your word that is like a seed that will grow and will grow and bear fruit. Lord, may that seed of truth continue to grow within us, helping us to continue to see you and worship you, to continue to shape our heart and our minds and our thoughts, to continue to be at the center of our actions, to be at the place, to be within us. Lord, thank you for your word, for your truth, for your love, for your grace, and for your forgiveness. Amen. Amen. We've been talking about the parables of Jesus for some time, and parables are a story with a point, a story that have meaning, and a story that uses lots of everyday objects. But as we've been looking at some of these parables, we also see that there's a piece of it that as Jesus shares these parables, there's an accountability that comes with it, a built-in piece. That says, what are you going to do with this? What's going to be different? How are you going to live? And we come to this parable, and it doesn't quite have that same sense of accountability. But as we go through it, we'll see that it really is an end result. What will life be like? Because in this parable, we have the wheat and the weeds growing together. If you're at King James Version or RSV, it's the wheat and the tares. And so as we begin, I want to just have you take your hands, kind of intertwine your fingers. Now try to pull them apart. Does it hurt a little as you're trying to take that apart? If you really feel like you trust your neighbor, maybe have your neighbor try to pull them apart. And then you can get that sense of them pulling and sometimes the pain that comes with that. Because that's kind of the way this parable is being played out, and at least as I understand it and look at it, is you have these wheats that are growing up, and you have these weeds, and their roots are becoming intertwined and intertangled. And that's why that master says, leave them be, let them grow together. Because if you pull one, you're going to pull the other out as well. And you're going to cause damage to the wheat because it's not ready to come out. It's not really, it hasn't reached its full potential yet. And it begins with this parable, begins with this master. We see that master as being God, planting good seeds, planting good people, putting people out into the world, which is the field, and having them grow. Giving them the water and the nourishment they need. Giving them the sunshine and the love and the care that they'll need. But there's also another that comes in the middle of the night and doesn't plant nice seeds and wants to cause this havoc and this destruction. And we see that in our everyday life, don't we? Excuse me. We see that all around us. Because we ask those questions. The question of, why is there bad? The question of you know, I'm a good person, and there's, but this person beside me is not so nice, is not so good. And why do we receive the same things? Why is there sun for both of us? Why is there good fortune for both of us? I live a proper life. I have faith. I have understanding. I know what God is doing. But this person denies God. Why is it that they're growing? Why is it that they have extra resources? Why is it that they have the nice house? And I think as we look at this parable, I think Jesus is helping us to understand that the wheat and the weeds need to grow together. He's not pouring out sunshine on one aspect and not another aspect. That he's not pouring out water on just a certain part of the city. He's just not hurting another part and another place. That they grow together. They come together. And we wrestle and we struggle with why. And we just don't, in our mind, we have this sense of justice and fairness that just doesn't, it makes sense to us, and it burns us up. Burns us up that this wheat and these weeds are together. But if we take a moment and think about it, those weeds, they help the wheat grow stronger, don't they? Yeah, there is potential that they could block the sun and they can take all the nutrients, that's true, and the wheat won't grow as strong or grow as high. There are times where we need those weeds to give us the strength that we need. That we need that struggling so that we can be stronger. That we need that to fight a little bit harder for that nourishment. That we need to dig into our faith and our understanding and see, to dig into who God is, to deepen that faith. To let God's love grow deeper and stronger, to let that forgiveness flow out of us. And not just to let it be a surface issue. Those weeds, they will have their day of accountability as well. They'll have that day where they're cut down, where they're bundled up and they're taken off. Where the weed is cut down and harvested and the fruit and the grain is used in a different way. Those actions will have their own consequences. And in that moment, as that accountability, we talked about accountability and the results, as that those results begin to get played out. It's not the wheat's job to decide who's a weed. It's not the wheat's job to push the weeds down. It's not the wheat's job to harvest itself. It's not the wheat's job to uproot everything. The wheat's job is to grow, is to produce grain. And so there's a lot of things playing out in this, there's a lot going on in here, and again, those wheat and those weeds are tied together. And I think as we look at this, as this parable comes alive, I think it's obvious that we are the wheat, followers of Christ. And we have these things that we want to do and we want to accomplish and we want to say is this is how to be and this is how to go. And we provide that example, that's true. But just like that wheat has a job to produce grain, we're producing forgiveness and love. It's not our position to take the wheat away. We have the same resources. We have the same love. We have the same care. We have the same opportunities. This is where the parable kind of breaks down for me. That if that weed wants to transform into a wheat, our natural laws will not allow that, first of all. But God's supernatural laws begins to change that and transform that. God's supernatural laws begins to change that weed into wheat. And that wheat begins to produce fruit. And that's what that this is part of that parable that breaks down in a long term. But just that opportunity to be that wheat is huge. Because that opportunity to become that wheat then means that harvest, that grain that is produced, has an opportunity to plant a seed into someone else's life, has an opportunity to produce more wheat, and an opportunity to produce that forgiveness. And to have that hope, to have that truth, to have that trust. We might want to wave the wands that say, take away all the weeds. Take away all the bad people. Take away all the evil. And sometimes when we cry out to God, that's what we want to have happen. But if we take a moment and we don't have that weed, life would be easier. Life would be a little bit calmer. But we wouldn't be the person that we are. If we're going to carry it out a little bit more, there's a part of you that is a weed still. Right? Unless you have it all together. And if you have it all together, then please, I'll gladly switch places for you because I'd like to learn too. And dependent upon that moment when that field is harvested, if we're just going to be a wheat and weed alternate, that accountability is there. And the sermon is going absolutely in too many bad places for me right now. So I'm going to ask for your forgiveness, as this isn't as easy as I thought it was going to be. Because the wheat is a wheat and weed in a field growing together. It's a place of where we are. Is a reality that we're living in. Is a place that we see every day. And there's this moment in time where the harvest will come. And the wheat will be separated. And it comes to that moment is what does a wheat look like? And as I think about it, that wheat has forgiveness. That wheat also has the love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. That wheat is nourished. That wheat is loved. That wheat is cared for. The wheat is loved. That wheat is cared for. But that wheat doesn't have the same fruit. It doesn't have, that hasn't received that forgiveness, doesn't have that love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. It's missing. And it becomes that part of our life and our day and our moment that maybe we need to look at our hearts and say, where am I? Am I a wheat? Or am I a weed? And if I'm that wheat, what can I do to keep being stronger? What can I do to keep deepening that faith and that heart? We can continue to be a community and continue to trust. We can continue to love. We continue to work together. And if I'm a weed, how do I get to become a wheat? I think in that moment, that's where that forgiveness of God comes in and that transformation begins to start. And I begin to look at what God, who God is and what God means. And it comes over time. But there will be a time where we're going to be held accountable for our actions. There'll be a time when where there is a place that we will struggle. A place where our heart is. A part where the grain will either come to harvest, or the weed will show itself. And what will our actions show? This morning we have an opportunity for communion, an opportunity for us to see that transformation take place. And our Wesley heritage, our Wesley tradition, our Wesley understanding that this table is open for all people. For wheats and weeds. There's no one who's denied. Because in this moment is an opportunity for God to meet us and to walk with us, for us to be changed, to be transformed, for us to see the body and the blood of Christ being broken and poured out for us. For us to see that forgiveness did come at a cost. And for us to receive that forgiveness. Forgiveness is looking at that wrong. Knowing it's there, but looking past it. Saying it's no longer held against you. It's no longer a part of who you are. It's no longer a part of your life. And when God looks at us, He's offering us that forgiveness for us. That wrong, that sin, is no longer a part of us. When Jesus was on that cross and He says, Father, forgive them. To me, that's the most beautiful words that are there. Because God's looking at me, Jesus is looking at me and saying that it's no longer held against you. you no longer have to be that weed. You're now that grain. And you have this seed that you can plant into others. Because you can show them what forgiveness looks like. And you can allow it to work in their heart just like it's working in yours. Communion is that beautiful expression of that bread and of that cup. A beautiful expression of that forgiveness and that love. A beautiful expression of a hope that we no longer have to worry about, because that hope is ours. That forgiveness is ours. That love is ours. So this table is not just for those who have accepted. This table is for all people. No matter where you are or who you are. Because this opportunity is yours. This morning I've asked Nancy if she would come and share with us in this ritual, in reading of these words. But they're more than just words. It's more than just bread and juice. It's love and forgiveness being poured out.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as we come to your table today, your word reminds us that all have sinned and fallen short of your desire for our lives. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us now, we pray, as we offer our personal prayers of confession and silence to you. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
See, God loves the world so much, and God loves you so much, that he gave his only Son, Jesus. And whoever believes in him should not perish, but may have eternal life. The Bible also tells us that if we confess our sins, that he will forgive us, and God is faithful and just and will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And may it be so with us today.
The table is prepared. Let us ask the Lord's blessing. Please continue with me in prayer. He has sent it to be with you in glory, and according to his promise is with us always.
And on the night he offered himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to his disciples and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Therefore, in remembrance of all your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we ask you to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, which we offer in union with Christ's sacrifice for us as a living and holy surrender of ourselves.
And send the power of your Spirit on us and on these gifts, that as we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we may know the presence of the living Christ, be one body in him, cleansed by his blood, faithfully serve him in the world, and look forward to his coming and final victory. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
The bread which we eat is a sharing in the body of Christ.
The cups which we drink is a sharing of the blood of Christ. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. This morning we'll be receiving communion at two stations, one at the front on my left and on my right. As those communion ushers would come forward, and as they go to their station, I was going to ask you to come forward. We ask that you just take a piece of bread and a cup, and you can partake at the altar rail, the communion elements themselves. Also, if you have some gluten issues, there are some gluten options in the cup in the center of the bread plate as well. So please come and take.